gentlemen, welcome to the Source Material Comics Podcast. I have come out of my cocoon, my essential work cocoon, as it will, to come back for a special week. We're getting into, that's right, ladies and gentlemen, we're going to be getting into Picard Countdown. Mark Radulich, you are here to let our listeners know why we are doing Star Trek Picard Countdown. Tell them all about it.
It's the prequel comic to the CBS All Access exclusive television show, Star Trek Picard.
Yeah, are you guys doing something on the network for that?
We are. Me and the two Canadians, Andrew Graham and David Wright, will be talking Star Trek Picard tomorrow for a TV party tonight.
Oh, now, I think I know where your allegiance lies here when it comes to Star Wars or Star Trek.
I mean, can I like both my children?
You can. You can. Do you like one more than the other, though?
Probably for the longest time, I liked Star Wars more than Star Trek. I think if you were like, do you want to watch one of the first three, and I mean by first three, Star Wars, Empire, A New Hope, Empire, Jedi, or do you want to watch Wrath of Khan, Search for Spock, The Voyage Home? Nobody wants to watch Star Trek V. But if I wanted to watch Star Trek's 2, 3, 4, or 6, I would probably pick a Star Wars 9 out of 10 times. But I will tell you, as I tried to tell my work wife, when she was trying to pitch me Don't Fuck with Cats, I was like, well, you should watch Star Trek 2, The Wrath of Khan. And she said, nerd, and hung up on me. To answer your question in a non-stupid way, I typically prefer Star Wars more than Star Trek. But it's hard because Star Trek has so much more to it in terms of properties and length of time to enjoy. Yeah. You have six original cast movies, I think three seasons of original cast show, and then you have seasons of TNG.
I think seven.
Seven seasons of TNG, six or seven movies of TNG, and then you have Deep Space Nine, which I've been referencing a lot. There's an episode of Deep Space Nine where they're dealing with the Dominion, and there's a meeting between two of the Starfleet officers and a Klingon, and they're like, let's just make sure we know who we are who we say we are, and they all have to cut their hands. I feel like that's what you got to do with temperatures now.
Oh, okay.
I was never a huge fan of Voyager. Mm. I've seen a couple of episodes. It was very UPN. If you know, UPN back in the day. It was very, like, so I know some people love it, but I Captain Janeway was always trying to crash the ship, and I was like, I can't deal with this. And then I never watched Enterprise because by that point I was kind of over Star Trek. I haven't watched Discovery because I've heard it's hot garbage. But now that I have the free month of All Access, so you know, if I get through all the stuff we're podcasting on and I have some extra time, I might actually give it a shot. And then, you know, and that takes us to Picard. I've actually watched... Oh, wait, this is tomorrow we're reviewing it. I've watched the whole season, but I can mostly tell you what I thought of the first episode.
That's great. I want to need that because I haven't watched any of this at all, and I wanted to because TNG is by far my favorite Star Trek property. I think it hit me right at that age where I was starting to enjoy sci-fi a lot. I think I was probably catching the reruns mostly when I was about 14 or 15 years old. I think they were running reruns on Fox. They had this great lineup where it was TNG, and then it was like at 10 o'clock at night, if I remember right, either 10 o'clock or 9 o'clock, but TNG was on. And then after that, it was Andy Griffith. So I love that back to back. It didn't make any sense, but it was perfect for me. I remember the newer episodes coming out. I remember watching like the very first episode. That would have been 1987, I think. It was either 87 or 88 when TNG first episode released. And I was like, oh, this is pretty cool. And my dad was kind of a sci-fi guy. I can remember going and watching some of the original movies with him. My stepdad was as well. He was more into Star Trek than my actual dad was. And we went and watched five. I went and watched five with my stepdad, went and watched six with my real dad. You know, as a fan of the original series movies, and then I got into TNG a little bit, watched it a good bit, and I like the characters and I like the stories, and most of the episodes that I could actually sit down and enjoy. And just, you know, just imagine old Jesse's crossover starcher watching Star Trek Generations occur.
What a garbage movie that is.
Oh, well, you're full of shit. And then things are, you don't know things are wrong. So what's the problem with that movie?
It sucks. It's so stupid. It wastes like an epic confrontation between Kirk and Picard.
An epic confrontation?
An epic crossover.
Okay. I was going to say a confrontation between the two captains.
Could have been. Maybe. I don't know. I just always thought that I thought Generations was, it wasn't even like a good idea executed poorly. I feel like it was like an idea that needed a movie. You know, in the sense that like we need to do a bridge movie between the Kirk movies and the Picard movies that are going to be coming out. So let's put them in the movie. Okay, but why are they in the same movie? There's an area of
space that
there's an area of space that makes you feel like you're wrapped in a warm blanket. Thanks, Whoopi. Ugh.
Okay. All right. So maybe it could have been a little bit more, sci-fi. All right, whatever. But I enjoyed when they brought the two properties together, and it was kind of like the passing of the torch. Long story short, I'm a fan of TNG, so I'm a fan of Picard, so I really wanted to watch the series, and I just haven't had a chance to get around to it. So, needless to say, we hop into this prequel. All right, this comes out in late 2019. Matter of fact, the last issue of it just dropped, I think, in January of 2020. We're looking at a Picard that has become an admiral. So, just real quick, the creative team here. Written by Kristen Bayer and Mike Johnson. Art by Angel Hernandez and colors by Joanna LaFuente. So this is Star Trek Picard Countdown, only a 3-issue series. But again, like you said, it's a prequel coming into the first episode. So remember when we did that fucking Bumblebee prequel and it was like, what the fuck is going on here? There's James Bond and all that bullshit. That's kind of what I thought we were going to get with this, which this is the same company, by the way. This is IDW.
No, this really is the backstory to the first episode of Picard.
Great, 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 great. All right, well, here's the synopsis. Admiral Picard is serving a diplomatic rescue mission aboard the starship USS Verity in the neutral zone, which is the barrier for anybody that's not a Star Trek fan. I apologize up front, but I will explain a few things here. The barrier between Romulan, which are some pretty, at one time hostile and mistrusting aliens, the Romulans and Federation space. So their purpose is to help evacuate Romulan planets that are going to be in the path of a star that's on the verge of going supernova. When Picard is sent to an unknown Romulan colony on a planet called Uat Beta, the years of mistrust between the Romulans and the Federation are yet to be forgotten. When local Romulan governor Shiana enacts a plot to capture Picard and his ship, the local population, indigenous to the planet, attack the governor's palace, rescuing Picard. Matters get more complicated when the two leading the revolt are Romulans Zabon and Laris, a pair of lovers who just also happen to be members of the Tal Shiar. Now, I copied and pasted some stuff from a Star Trek wiki, all right? Here we go. The Tal Shiar, or Imperial Security Service, was an elite intelligence agency, highly respected and feared both inside and outside the Romulan Star Empire. Its purpose was to guard the security of the Empire from alien enemies and from traitors within the Romulan population itself. The covert, often invisible presence of the Tal Shiar kept the general populace in a constant state of paranoia for fear that any signs of dissent or dissatisfaction with the status quo might result in their arrest. So that's who the Tal Shiar are. So just imagine a couple agents dispatched to this planet, kind of keep an eye on things that are going on this planet. And these two agents end up falling in love. So that's Zabon and Laris.
Like the Romulan CIA.
There you go. That's a good one. When the pair help Picard regain control of the Verity, a Tal Shiar cruiser decloaks off the bow and Zabon reveals he is there to destroy the ship. However, when Laris refuses to go along with the plot, Zabon explains he is not going to go through with it, as it was his love for Laris that opened his eyes, that made him realize his duty to protect Romulan citizens was not being fulfilled if he destroyed the one ship that came there to rescue them. Just then, two Dideric's class warships decloak, allies of Picard, convincing the Tal Shiar ship to retreat. At the end of the book, Zabon and Laris are trying to find a place to live as their planet is being evacuated, and Jean-Luc convinces them to come to Earth to work in a vineyard. And I don't know if it's his vineyard or
it's just his vineyard.
So they're working in his vineyard.
Chateau Picard.
There we go. And that is kind of where we leave that. So, you know, one person I did not even bring up in my, and I didn't even bring her up in my synopsis, but we've just got to talk about this right now. What do you think of Commander Raffi Musquier? First off, is she in the series?
Yes.
Okay. Is she as annoying as shit in this, as she is in this book?
You'll have to watch the series.
Oh, okay. Thanks, Mark. All right.
I don't want to give it away, Jesse.
Yeah, I understand. My notes, my one and only note for this lady, who happens to be, I would assume, like, it's either commanding officer or whatever.
I don't understand how she got to be, like, leadership in Starfleet, first of all.
You do not go around fucking calling an admiral by his, she's calling him JL.
What up, JL? Deuces.
I'm like, what are you doing? Here's what I didn't like. Okay. At the beginning, she walks in, she says, blah,
like, blah. Like, JL, my Negro. Like, what are you doing?
slap me some skin.
Oh, give me five. Up high, down low, too slow.
Change of plans, JL. That's what she opens it up. She opens the door. She goes, change of plans, JL. And he goes, you're never going to call me Admiral again, are you? Well, she doesn't for the rest of this book, because they shove that right down your throat. She calls him JL just about any conversation that they have.
It works in First Contact when he's paired up with, I can't remember the actress's name. But it works with her because she doesn't owe him that respect.
Yeah, yeah.
And part of the arc of First Contact is him dealing with the trauma of having been reconjigged by the Borg.
Mm-hmm.
And so, you know, when she's like screaming at him, like, you know, the Borg are your Moby Dick, you know, and you're Captain Ahab trying to get, you know, just trying to get that whale to the exclusion of all else and to the pain of everyone around you. And so that's an important element of that movie. And she's a good character to give that to because she's not one of his, you know, officers. Unless he goes off the fucking rails, that shouldn't come from like a Geordi or a Riker or somebody.
Yeah. Yeah. Alfre Woodard is her name.
Yes. Alfre Woodard is like, I think like an award nominated actress.
Playing Mariah Stokes and Luke Cage.
That's right.
Yeah.
Hell yeah.
I see where you're coming from. And then this lady, this...
Right. Isn't she like a yellow shirt? I thought those people were all like mechanics and engineers and shit.
I don't know, man. I know.
How
she
are you
just
second in command on the ship?
Made me so... I just didn't like it. I didn't like it at all. And if she continues her shenanigans, which I don't know if this is how... I would assume if you're writing a prequel, obviously you've got to know. Bumblebee proven me wrong there. But you've got to know what's coming up in the upcoming show and who these characters are and how they're represented. I have no doubt in my mind that whoever wrote Jean-Luc Picard has had the opportunity to see how that character is supposed to be portrayed.
Whoever wrote this comic looked at, like, you know, all of the TNG and TNG movies and were like, you know what the most common trait about Picard and all of these different movies and television shows is? He likes black women, and he lets them get away with all kinds of shit. I feel like that was their takeaway. So we'll write this black character in there and just let her fucking have carbon. You know, yep. And just call him, you know, it's just like, hey, Whitey, you know, and he's like, oh, I love it when you call me White Chalk. It's ridiculous. Like, they just think that there's no reason for her to act that way. You don't know enough about their relationship, you know, and again, maybe they get into it in the show, maybe they don't, but that's...
Lieutenant Commander Raffi Musquier, so that's her name.
Yeah.
So she's... I'm trying to think of what, if anything, really character-wise, other than her just really kind of like annoying personality.
She has moxie.
Yeah, okay, all right. And then I don't even know. I mean, she goes down to the planet with Picard, and they both get captured.
Asshole.
Do you remember, like, does she even get into anything, like, to where she saves the cat, has some kind of specific skill set or anything? No, I don't even remember that.
fucking useless.
Okay.
Because even before things go sideways, they're on a diplomatic mission to save, you know, to save the Romulan colony from the impending supernova. It's touchy with the Romulans because they clearly need the Federation to get billions of people out of their empire, away from this exploding sun, but they don't trust the Federation, and they think this is all just a big gambit, you know, to cripple them and spy on them and all this other stuff. So, like, they're between a rock and a hard place, and so it's delicate, and it really needs just the most deftest touch, you know what I mean, to deal with them. And she's, like, a bull in a fucking china shop in the first, like, 5 minutes of the conversation, to where I think where, like, Picard's, like, pushes her in the pool. It's like, all right, what she's trying to say is, like, you know, and then they're captured, and, you know, like, she, like, fucks off for a few panels, you know, and then everything that happens after that is because the Tal Shiar got involved and saved them.
You know, one of the other big plot points was when, I don't say big, but, I mean, they get down there and they realize that the Romulans, they're expecting 10,000 Romulans to get on to this ship so they can get them off the planet. And it turns out there's another, like, I don't know, 5 million
Native aliens on there.
Yeah, Native aliens. So there's a little bit of what I think I told you this. It's societal commentary along with a little bit of sci-fi wrapped up in a bow.
Yeah.
The discussion of colonization happens.
A moral quandary, isn't it?
Sure.
Because let's say you're an antebellum plantation owner, and you have your wife and your two kids, but you also have, like, 10 black slaves.
Mm-hmm.
For whatever reason, you have to, like, evacuate the plantation.
Yeah.
And you can only get X amount of number of people on the covered wagon. You're leaving those black people behind.
You're getting your family.
Yeah.
And you're going. Yeah.
And it sucks. And I'm not saying it's right, but that's the reaction that would happen. It's like, yeah, these aren't people. These are livestock.
Mm-hmm.
Now, were they all treated that way throughout the wide berth of slavery throughout history? No, but many did. You know, black people under slavery were seen by many, unfortunately, as chattel.
Mm-hmm.
They were equipment, and that's it. They were not people.
Tal Shiar, lovers, forbidden. What do you think of Zabon and Laris?
It smelt a little of the two kids playing in the yard, and one's like, I got a force field. Well, I got a sword that penetrates your force field. I mean, they're fine characters, and they show up right at the beginning of Picard.
The first episode.
They're living on the chateau, taking care of the winery, and Picard are kind of his, like, live-in servants.
Do they actually, are they really?
I mean, like, they're, you know, they're not, like, walking around in, like, butler outfits or anything.
Okay,
French
all right.
maid outfits, but they're taking care of him because he's 900 years old, and they're taking care of the winery and just living.
Okay.
Living their lives.
Have you ever heard of the Tal Shiar before getting into this?
Yeah, vaguely. I mean, I knew that they were a thing, but I don't remember that much about them.
If there's anything that I could say about if you're picking up a Star Trek comic, just be prepared. There's going to be probably references to a lot of things that you may not be completely familiar with, because they're going to possibly take for granted that you are aware of what's going on in the universe. You know, it wasn't like I was completely lost. I figured out that, you know, they kind of like who they were, obviously, because it was essential to the plot. At the end of things, you know, the Tal Shiar ship shows up and Zabon's going to supposedly blow the ship up, but that's not the case. He decides not to.
They kept changing it. It was just like, oh, we're telling you this because of this reason. Oh, I lied. I'm really here to do this. Oh, but I'm going to do this. And that. Like, it just, like, they kept moving the goalposts. It was like, oh, Jesus Christ.
I think
it seemed like they would hit a wall with the story and they were like, they changed their mind.
Well, I assume what they were trying to drive home there was because the Tal Shiar, okay, the Romulans can't be trusted. The Tal Shiar cannot be trusted at all. Like, oh, well, I should, okay. Obviously, if you're a secret police inside of some fucking society that already is just all sorts of secretive, okay, already, it's just like that on top of that. And I think Picard makes reference, like, a couple times. He's like, oh, you're a member of Tal Shiar. Well, you know, how do I believe anything that you say?
Right.
But yeah, I've never heard of them before going into this. So I was like, oh, man. Is there some episodes that I've missed? There was a reference, apparently, you know, I can't remember. They mentioned DS9, so I don't know if there was an episode that had a reference to Tal Shiar in it. But either way, so love conquers all, though, Mark Radulich, because these two fell in love on the planet. And when push came to shove, the only reason that Zabon made the right move is because he fell in love with Laris. So What do you think of that? Too cute?
It's fine. I mean, that's
the classic. It's fine.
Look, the parts of the story that I liked were the governor of the colony and Picard kind of having a tete-a-tete. You know, I like the idea that these Tal Shiar were not a part of the colony. They were sleeper agents and they were like, well, we can't just let them die. The best part of the comic for me is sort of the moral quandary. Like, you know, like the governor makes a point of saying, like, you don't have the moral high ground. You did the same shit to your own people.
Oh, yeah. When they were talking about colonization.
Yeah. Like, we tried to, before we started importing blacks from Africa, we tried to make Native American slaves and they did not hold up under the physical pressure from what I've read.
Mm.
They, you know, the Indians, it didn't work out, you know, and so they brought over a lot of slaves they bought from warring African tribes. History with Rattledge. But there's a lot of that, you know, and I go back to if let's get out of America. If you were like, you know, if you are the British Empire and for whatever reason, there's an evacuation having to take place, you're leaving the Scotch behind, you know, like the Scotch and the Irish can just fucking die.
We're out.
Yeah. For a while there, like China had been like conquered or, you know, or in, like invaded by the Japanese. And if they had the time, there had to have been that an evacuation of some sort, the Japanese would have let the Chinese just fucking die.
Mm.
So there's that. They're like, you don't get to have the moral high ground here. But for Picard, I don't even think it's a moral high ground. I think it's a personal ethic. It's, I am a man who believes that all life is precious and that you should not leave, you know, millions of sentient beings to die on this planet because you don't think they measure up to your, you know, to your cultural standard. And they're like, it's not your fucking call, asshole. It's our empire.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, and so it's like, well, what do you do? Because you're in a, at the very least, an armistice with the Romulans. Where, like, mm-hmm. you know, we can't afford to be fighting right now. You know, do you condemn the entire Romulan empire to get blowed up by the supernova because of this moral stance? Or do you take everybody? And if the Romulans are like, go fuck yourself.
Yeah.
No. Like, you can't take them. What do you do? It, you know, it becomes a matter. So it's that sticky situation. It's like it's a matter of sovereignty. Like, I remember when we talked about the Orville.
Yeah.
And it was a, you had a moral question versus a civilization's sovereignty and their own culture in the transitioning a baby episode.
Oh yeah, yeah.
It was like, we have a moral objection to this, and I can't remember the race of the people. The Mocklins. And the Mocklins are like, yeah, fuck you and your morals.
Mm-hmm.
You're not a Mocklin. And it's
exactly.
Not, it, this isn't a Federation issue, it's a Mocklin issue.
Mm-hmm.
And therein lied, you know, like if you just look at things as moral absolutes, well, sure, you don't let people die. That seems pretty straightforward.
Yeah.
But societies have laws, and and at what point, you know, it's like the state's rights versus the federal government thing. You know, the states have X, you know, are allowed to do X. The federal government oversees Y, and occasionally the twains meet, and that's what we have a Supreme Court for. Civics with Rattledge. So
oh boy.
But
so
but
many
because,
podcasts have been debuted on this show.
But because these questions get asked, that's why you have these systems to have that debate, because sometimes the answer is not easy. And for me, I thought that was handled. I mean, you can't do three issues of this sort of moral arguing, but they spent some time
with boring pretty quick.
Yeah. They spent some time with it in the first issue and it was addressed. And I saw both sides of it. And I'm like, wow, this is really fun. This is interesting. This is kind of what I like about the TNG era of Star Trek, because it dealt a lot with philosophical moral quandaries.
Yeah, yeah.
And then the Romulans started shooting everybody. And then after that, it was just like, I've taken over the ship. No, you haven't. Oh, you're right, I haven't.
Damn
you've
it.
Taken over the ship. No, you haven't. Oh, you're right, we didn't. Put the cuffs on.
Got it. I wasn't going to do that anyway.
Yeah, it kind of goes off a cliff after that. Did I like the series? I like the idea of the series, and there were definitely elements of the first issue that I liked. After that, it's just kind of, it unfortunately is the product of modern Star Trek, Because if you look at, like, the 66 show and TNG, a lot of it is, again, like, Gene Roddenberry's vision for Star Trek was, what if there were no racism or sexism or religious hatred, and we just had to deal with issues set in space?
Mm-hmm.
And occasionally, like, Kirk banged a green gal, or, you know, you had some action going on, or they went into a parallel universe and Spock with a mustache was stabbing people. It's fine. It's all fine. But the crux of Star Trek, and it's probably why maybe as an adult I can appreciate it more, but as a kid I preferred Star Wars, Star Trek was a thinker's show.
Yeah.
And TNG was definitely a thinker's show until they realized nobody was watching because it made you think too much. And they were like, fuck the Borg.
Yeah.
It's killing everybody. All right. Fucking Locutus. Yeah.
Which, of course, gets a reference in this comic. I had a feeling if there can't be a Picard fucking comic without a reference to that. There
show without a Locutus and a Seven of Nine reference.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. I mean,
they could at this point, they could redo Star Trek 66 and Seven of Nine will show up. but that is, and I think this is as good a podcast as it, because I don't know when we're going to do another Star Trek show again. That is the problem with, like, modern Star Trek. And Deep Space Nine fell into the same pattern of, here is a show about a space station on the other side of the world, and what is that like? And, like, oh, nobody's watching. Fuck, have the Klingons attack.
Yeah.
You know, like, oh, they're watching now. Fuck, who else can attack this space station? The Dominion.
That's right.
It all comes full circle. So, modern Star Trek with Chris Pine and Zach Overies, whatever his name is, Zachary Quinto.
Mm-hmm. Why? Zach Overies.
Zach Overies. Zachary Quinto, same guy, right?
No.
All right. And Gamora from Guardians of the Galaxy.
Uh-huh. Yep. You're right there.
You know, it was like, okay, we're going to modernize Star Trek. We're going to reboot this thing. We're going to do Star Trek 66. Okay, but, like, everyone's an idiot and nobody wants to watch a thinking man Star Trek. I know. Throw the Beastie Boys in there.
There we go. Money.
Everything's blowing up to the sound of Sabotage, which makes everything better. I get it, but that's not Star Trek.
Mm-hmm.
And so this comic, I will end this rant that I've just been on. This comic kind of falls into that same pattern where it's like, here is this moral quandary. Here is this sort of debate going on. Here is Jean-Luc Picard doing his famous, the line must be drawn, yeah. And it's like, I will not be moved off my moral stance. And they're like, yeah, but you don't have a lot of choices here. You're not the one in charge of the Romulan Empire, and you can't just let these people die because fuck them.
Mm-hmm.
So, and I liked a lot of that, but then it's like, as soon as they're done dealing with that, they're like, okay, now to get to the punchy parts, because no one will read a philosophical rag.
That was one of the things that I respected about the TNG, was actually watching. I would rather watch them try to do, like, some detective work or something to figure out, like, whatever situation they were in, than a complete, like, action, you know, set phasers to kill or whatever. You know, and that's mostly what you didn't get with all the TNG episodes. They were usually, you know, some kind of situation that the team early was put
episode.
In. Yeah,
after the early episodes is like, oh, we're just a farming community. Don't you understand?
That was all the budget could afford, Mark Radulich, you see. And then popularity started, and then we started to get some pretty good, you know, space battles with the Borg, just like you were talking about. So they're trying to do with this series is just a mix of all that to try and keep people hooked. And so I would agree with you there. What do you think, you know, last question here about the book. Do you think it felt like a good setup to the first episode?
I definitely feel like having read it added to, I'll use the word enjoyment, added to my enjoyment of Picard. I feel like, because Picard begins with a thing has happened. He's no longer in Starfleet. It alludes to the Romulan supernova, and you don't get a whole lot more detail than that or why those two people are with him. I won't tell you one way or the other if it deals with any of the stuff that the comic book talks about beyond that, because you'll have to just listen to us talk about it on TV Party Tonight tomorrow. But...
You know, I've called her Raffi Muskier. I think her name is Raffi Musiker.
So, to answer your question, yeah, I think the comic book does a fine job of sort of coloring in and really preparing you to watch, too. Because I read the book first, And then I started watching the show, and I'm like, oh, okay. I'm not as confused as I would have been if I had just went in cold.
Mm-hmm.
So I think if you like comic books and you are willing to read a Star Trek comic book, it's worth a read. I think it definitely, like I said before, follows in the same pattern that TNG did, which is, all right, here's some smart stuff for you smart people. Okay, not too much, though, because the rest of you are dumb as shit. Here's the punchy parts.
All right, well, you know what? I think we have finished our discussion about Star Trek Picard, 3-issue series coming from you from IDW. That's right, IDW. All right, Mark, let's talk about the schedule. What do we got upcoming on the Rattlitch in Broadcasting Network?
Okay, tomorrow is a TV party for Picard. Wednesday, I think me and Robert are going to review the new, Robert Winfrey, are going to review the new Nightwish. And then Jesse is back, and then you're never going to see him again.
I'm essential AF, Mark. Essential AF.
You are essential as fuck. We'll be finally getting around to reviewing Ozark Season 3. All right, in theory, last week, myself and people did a TV party
myself
for.
And people. Hey, who do you got on your network? Well, let me plug the people. It's people.
It's the People's Republic of Rattlitch. We did a TV party for Akritsuko. Myself and Jesse Starcher reviewed the New Testament album, Titans of Creation. Poor Chuck Billy. We hope he recovers. And then myself and Pat Mullen reviewed the Big Show show. If you like situation comedies and, you know, of like the Fuller House variety, canned laughter, the kind of TGIF vibe, the Big Show show was actually really sweet. I really enjoyed it. I mean, it helps to be a wrestling fan, but even if you're not, there were some good laughs with this. I thought this was a very well-written show. And the last two episodes, one of which is kind of a This Is Your Life, and, you know, what happens if the Big Show never left the road and didn't come home to his family? Like, how would they be? And I'll tell you, and Pat and I talked about it last week, but it definitely makes you reflect upon, because I don't know if you go through this, but sometimes, like, I get down on myself and I reflect on my role with my family, and I feel like, oh, well, they wouldn't miss me if I were gone. My wife kind of runs the show and I'm just here, and, you know, it wouldn't matter. And you realize what an impact you have as a father on your kids and on your household, even if you're not running like the day-to-day operations. That episode made me reflect on that and realize, wow, I am in a super important part of this family, even though I don't do the stuff that my wife does. I have a whole other role, but it's equally, maybe even in some ways, more so important. So,
mm-hmm.
And the Big Show show kind of dealt with that towards the end, which I thought was fun.
Chuck Billy, by the way, he's recovered. He's all right.
Oh, good.
Yeah, three or four. They had a Rolling Stone interview with him. This was back on March 27th. So I think he's been okay for a while now.
Good.
So there you go. Answers there. Big Show, continue.
That's it. That's all I got. I'm done talking now.
Hey, he's done talking now. All right. Well, it's been a while since I've done plugs, so let's see how we do. ladies and gentlemen, go give the Rattlitch in Broadcasting Network Facebook page a like to stay up on top of all the great podcasts that we have to offer. We are part of the W2M network. So if you type that into any Google machine, you should be able to find the website, find all the podcasts. Don't forget to go to any podcatcher, type in W2M.net. Most likely you're going to be able to find our podcast and all the other great podcasts on the network, such as That Wrestling Show, The Podsmen Return, which that was, you guys hadn't, then what, been a week or so since you guys,
Yeah, it was the 7th.
They have returned, ladies and gentlemen. Did a WrestleMania review.
The Pods all, been featuring Easy.
Yes, all the hacks and coughs can be held. and listen to them with, put your headphones on. Listen to them in stereo. Mark, I know you're going to be part of this show at some point, and I had the opportunity to hop on there. And I, from what I understand, I am going to be part of this show. Sheehan's only going to be recording once a month. This is his plan for From Claremont to Claremont, which is an X-Men related podcast. It is the first episode dropped, ladies and gentlemen. It is a 6 minute shy of 10 hours of podcast epicness. Sheehan did, maybe 6 or 7 different podcasts, recording with people, shoved them all into one big massive podcast. And at first I was like, oh man, I don't know if I could do this whole 10 hour thing. And I'm probably about an hour away from finishing it off. I was part of the Excalibur portion of that podcast. So if you get a chance, you can check that out. It's over there on chrisandreggie.com. You could probably type in the Cosmic Treadmill over on the on any podcast catcher, and you should be able to find that pretty easily. And my buddy, my good friend, Chris Armstrong came through and laid out an episode of the Source Material Comics podcast last week. Check it out. It's him, and it's Evan Bevins, and it is Al Sedano of Adam Warlock and Thanos podcast, where they are discussing the first volume of the 2018 reboot of The Amazing Spider-Man. That's Nick Spencer and Ryan Ottley's vehicle, and it was a fun time. I got to listen to that today and really enjoyed it. So
do one issue of that, and I fucking tore into it, and Ronnie ran away crying.
Yeah, we did. It was the split. We did a split 7-inch with Batman, the Batman wedding issue.
Oh, that's right. It was kind of like a what are you reading kind of a thing.
Yeah.
So we talked about the Spider-Man number one, and I was like, this is hot garbage, and I like threw it over the pinball table. Pinball machine.
If you listen to those guys when they talk about it, they had some kind of similar reactions. I remember Sedan, Al was saying, he's like, enough of this, like going back to the well over and over. Because if you remember right, Peter Parker's going great.
Complaint about it. It was like he had owned his own company. They were doing some really interesting things. Yep. Like, let's just take it all away and make him 18 again.
Yep. And he's remember he fucking got accused of fucking plagiarism.
Right.
In that one. So yeah, that's exact same complaints that they had. And they
I said no for a number of reasons, but one of the reasons was like I didn't want to be the one negative guy on there. So that's really funny, actually.
Well, they certainly wouldn't have. They weren't as negative as you could have been. I know that much. So they did a fine job, at least tempering. And of course, Evan Bevins, he's always a delight to have on. And he can rarely say anything bad about just about anything he reads. But he did have some criticism himself. But either way, Chris did a fantastic job hosting that. And he also did a couple unspoken issues. We got the Guardians of the Galaxy issue episode that he did just recently. And then I think I've got another one coming up here for Bad Rock and Company number 5, which was that was an image, I'm sure, a slam dunk fun time. Anyway, I think he's got something in the works to do another episode sometime upcoming for Jason Aaron's Star Wars, which should be probably a good discussion. I don't know who he's going to have on for that one, but either way, check it out. We got all sorts of podcasts, and I think that's it. I'm ready to get out of here. So for Mark Ratledge, make it so. Yes, make it so. That is Mark Ratledge. I am Jesse Starcher. Have a good one. Bye-bye.
Thank you very much for joining us. Do not forget to subscribe to our new home by punching in W2M Network on just about any podcast platform to get all of our content into your audio feed. Also, give a like to the Ratledge in Broadcasting Network and W2MNet.com Facebook page in order to stay on top of everything that we have to offer. If you'd like to follow the Source Material Podcast on social media, just follow @SourceMatCast on Twitter, and we are on Facebook @SourceMaterialComicsPodcast. If you enjoyed what you heard, please feel free to share. We look forward to entertaining you again soon.
It is a very the wrong way. Did they use two hands? Did you get like an Indian burn?
Just a little bit of palm burn on the old shaft.
Jesus fucking Christ, Starcher. You're off for like 5 months and you forget how to do the show. Nobody wants to watch next gen. Fuck. Do you miss this, Jesse?
Ah, so much. But I
heard it's very woke.
That's great. I'm glad it's fucking woke. What the fuck was that?
Except for where voting was concerned, and then they were only 2/3 of a person.
Probably
history by Ratledge. It's not the 2/3 compromise. I don't know why I said 2/3. It was the 3/5 compromise. Fractions, how the fuck do they work?
Fucking magnets. What is 2 divided by 3?
The answer is about 0.6666.
Okay. What is 3 divided by 5?
It's 0.6.
Oh, shit. Damn. You gave him a little too much credit, Mark. Oh, shit.
Children's singer, Raffy. Get it?
No.
You don't know who Raffy is?
I have no fucking clue who you're talking about. Sounds great.
I don't know why I listened to this podcast. That guy is so insulting. I'm not dumb.
That's great. Such honest answers coming from Mark Radulich right now.
You'd do worse to find something... I fucked it up. Do I sound like a crazy person?
He doesn't know. He's just sitting over there. He has no fucking clue.